do have a quorum, so I can begin. Seeing no public comment, we can move into the January minutes. Did everyone get a chance to review them?
I'm not sure I received them.
Did you not get them?
I don't think I got them, but maybe I did it.
I thought I did that fancy thing where I think sent out the same day.
Oh, maybe you did.
Not if none of you seem to have gotten them.
Well, let's see.
Any response by the panel?
You sent us the panhandling report recommendations.
Okay. Well, this moved to the next agenda. With my apologies, I really thought I had something to say. Well, you did see that I did send the commission's response to Mayor Narkowitz. And I have not heard back from the mayor about them, but I suspect that his attention has been on the override and he has not had a chance to turn his attention there. And relatedly, you have the text of the proposed text for the next column of the Gazette, which I culled largely from the report that we sent the mayor.
Do you mind to wait until you hear from the mayor?
Yes. The items I chose to highlight in this column, the ones that we thought had highest potential impact, and also with the thinking that this might be the first introduction to the report for some people reading the paper, and just give them a sense of some of the proactive responses that they offered. I apologize for not getting them to you earlier than the start of the meeting. It's always risky to offer group editing, but any responses, reflections?
My one suggestion is, I think the first paragraph could be stronger by just being more declarative as opposed to saying, you know, that he came to see us. That could go lower down, but like maybe a sentence that says, you know, after reviewing the report, the Human Rights Commission, you know, feels many of it. Well, I'm making some as I go along, but like some declarative statement, like we, you know, that we looked at it in terms of how it lines up with the Declaration of Human Rights, and you know, applaud the mayor for doing it, and many of its things do line up. You know, and so just something that would be a little more content. On the one other suggestion I have is, I know we said this in the meeting, but the code of ethics the point of the code of ethics being unenforceable. I think that our other criticisms of that is so much more important than the unenforceable. I almost feel like we might have, you could just lose the unenforceable part. Because it's kind of irrelevant when you think about the other stuff.
Yeah, I like that, to stop the being unenforceable.
But I like the ones you accepted.
How long is this? 739 words, something like that. 750 is the cap.
Yeah. And I'm also in favor of timing this so that it's not, it's not buried with all the other things going on right now.
After the election, I will ask them for, I'll follow up and ask them about timing from his perspective. Yeah, I don't even know what other agencies he's asked for feedback. So. Anything else on Mayor's report for now?
Thank you so much for doing this.
Yeah, I'm sorry about not getting the minutes out to you. All right. Speaking of being responsible for getting things out.
Wait, I have one more thought.
Yeah.
I just wonder if we should take the opportunity to, at the end, you know, it's not really related, but to say we have some openings if anybody's interested, be in touch with the mayor's office.
Oh, yes.
Sure.
Yes.
What?
Yes.
Yes.
We need to make history.
Yes.
Okay.
Opportunity we have.
Unless by some miracle, by the time it's printed.
Have you heard anything?
No, so I don't know if anyone has had direct asks with any folks or any leads.
We've got some city council members that help us with recruitment. So Karen Foster actually, she suggested an initiative to kind of maybe survey the current, you know, city offices and the volunteer board and commissions, demographic information, with the intent of maybe feeling how representative or not we are of the city, you know, in terms of gender and race and so forth. So that was proposed, I think, at the city services meeting. I gather from her that the response was supportive, but that there's a question of how this would be useful. So,
she proposed this specifically around R?
No. Oh. So all the, I think, city offices and volunteer commission boards.
Oh.
Too. And, you know, the thing is that this is not pre-existing data anyone has. So it would take some time, and I thought, you know, I feel like it's kind of aligns with what we want to do as well. So there's an opportunity to support her there, like to do that. So, yeah, I feel, because she feels like that's a kind of a first step for me, you know, because there are lots of vacancies, all those positions right now. So, you know, with the turnover, also, it just seems to be like an opportunity to really go in a more progressive direction. City to look, you know, our leadership to look the way we need to. So she has agreed to help there. Of course, Rachel knows the bar. That's a real need for us as well. Yeah. And
it's always been just random and sort of people volunteering, asking people, mentioning it to other people, with all the city boards.
Absolutely.
Although it says in our bylaws that we should actively recruit and recommend qualified members.
So in terms of the minutes, what should I say about Karen Foster? I kind of missed the beginning of that.
Okay. So she's proposed to survey, I think, the city offices and all volunteer boards, commissions for demographic data.
All city offices, like employees, so. And volunteer boards and commissions.
Okay. I will check on that again with her, but.
To get demographic data?
Yeah.
And how would that apply to us?
She made representation a priority, you know, in her role. And so I think we as the HRC would also like to ensure that there's more access and this sort of opportunity to people who have been historically underrepresented mm-hmm. here.
So maybe we can work with her then?
I think we can work with her.
Okay.
There's nothing really concrete as far as I know right now. I think she proposed this at a city services committee meeting. So yeah, I guess we can follow up with her about where that's going. But she said that, again, you know, the mayor seems receptive, but had questions about how this would be used. Because it does require, you know, staff to spend some time collecting this data, so. I don't have any other leads of my own. It comes up, recruitment comes up in conversations a lot. But again, this is just the 90-minute meeting month seems a little bit. It seems a little prohibitive to some people. Additionally, you know, any the work outside of this meeting that we would need to do to kind of, you know, drive our agenda forward. It's a challenge for a lot of people. So, I wish I had deeper connections around that city, but.
I wonder if it would be worthwhile just taking a few minutes to brainstorm, like, I don't know, likely places, likely categories of places we could maybe go to recruit, like,
One would be, is there somebody from the high school who would like to be on this commission?
Yeah.
like a employee?
Actually, student, I think, is.
Oh, really? Okay.
That's actually, I'm reading the qualifications.
Okay, so.
And one of the qualifications must be, must live, work, or be enrolled in school in order to be a member.
And it doesn't have an age thing?
I don't know whether they still have it, but they used to be a student on the school committee.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. They do, yeah. I also think it'll be good to have teaching.
Sorry, sir.
I said, I also think it'll be good to have a teacher.
Bring that up in the next PTO meeting, just at the high school, just asking for ideas.
You can bring it up.
As students or staff.
Yeah, you'll, okay.
I will. That meeting is probably in another week, so before our meeting, our March meeting.
In some ways, it's the same sort of places that we were thinking of doing the survey. The library, I would assume.
Senior center?
Various shelters.
Senior center.
Senior center.
I wonder about agencies like the Valley Worker Center or Center for New Americans.
Yeah.
We have a lot of kind of area expertise, but just, you know, this is time commitment. It's hard for people. I wonder if there's any possibility, I mean, of us amending the bylaws so that, I mean, is it in here that this is to be, and that we have to meet for 90 minutes? Or so much.
Actually, I thought what I read was that it says 2 hours.
Oh, I think it does.
Purposely to pop.
But I mean, we don't have to meet for 90 minutes, but I don't know how we could meet in less time. Like,
yeah, it's hard to move anything forward without that.
I mean, it seems to me monthly is like the minimum that you can do to do work. Meaningful work. So, and I mean, and we definitely don't, if we finish our work at 6:15, we can adjourn. But you mean like ways to make it more user friendly for people? I mean, if we did online, I guess, with Zoom meetings, but I don't know, like we don't really
have meeting laws that are.
Yeah, right, so.
It would be useful for us to have some kind of flyer.
Yeah.
You know, that we're recruiting to contact the mayor's office.
Well, if we did have a flyer, we could put it at the senior center and this, the Center for New Americans.
Yeah, I mean, we could divvy it up and each take it to five places. Five sort of public places, I would have thought.
Can we send out an email then to like maybe the large list of agency heads or something? Have we talked about this before? Like in relation
we really
to
have
the survey?
You mean in this by way of recruiting, you mean?
Yeah, just to let them know that we're actively recruiting.
Well, we have flyer link to send it out.
We can also put it out on social media.
After the election.
Well, two things. I mean, I like the idea of having a flyer because it's just good to hand it to somebody or email it or post it, but you sometimes make flyers and Noral sometimes make flyers. And, I mean, I'm not a flyer maker, so I don't have good time. We could ask Noral.
Yeah, I can ask Noral, but why don't we just, why don't we brainstorm what we want to put on the flyer.
Mm-hmm.
And either she or I will.
And you never know whether that's going to bring anybody in. And probably word of mouth is, mm-hmm. is the best one, but.
Well, we have, how many openings?
Three.
Three openings.
And.
Four.
Yes, four in June, five, whenever we can get you.
Once you've got enough of the call.
Yes, and if you're all gets into graduate school.
Right. Okay, that's a good point.
I don't know if you have thoughts about.
When am I? No, that's not an issue.
Okay.
Though, actually, one of the things to look at is, how long have you been on this commission?
It must be 3 years, because I just got reappointed.
I'm wondering if, that's what I'm trying to figure out, if I was here for you.
You were here before me, Booker, and I think I've been here 3 years, because I got reappointed, or maybe I went, came in the middle of somebody's, but I mean.
Yeah, I think we all have done that.
Yeah, that could be in the middle of somebody else's.
I guess, I do know, I was going through things, I do have notes, I took minutes in January 2017, so, at least that long.
And I think I more or less just joined when you took the view on that.
I'm asking because of the term, well, 6 years is the term.
Term, there is a term.
There's a term in it?
Yeah.
Each term is 4 years.
Right? But we can only do two consecutive?
Yeah, two consecutive.
That's good to know.
Yeah, no, it's in the document you sent.
Well.
If it's typical for people to come into that, it seems like it's more of a suggestion. There's no. There's nothing to really bind them to all 3 years. So, but I mean, is that something you want to consider changing? Term for any member of Human Rights Commission shall be 3 years. No member shall no more than two terms for 6 years in office as commission, whichever shall come first.
I don't know how many times people have had to be forcibly ejected. We're very glad to have
sort of
people.
From my place of being on boards of things, it's really bad to be on a board for more than 6 months.
Yes, I'm sure. I'm not from my experience.
So I could sort of imagine when that was being thought about, why that would be.
You can get throw them and die.
I won't go away. I think the challenge is how do you get people that aren't like the people who are already here?
Mm-hmm.
Yes,
that is the challenge.
And that's why it's sort of easy to talk about students mm-hmm. and teachers.
Mm-hmm.
But how do we get, you know, if you start putting things up in bookstores, that speaks to one group.
Mm-hmm.
It's sort of how do you get, you know, I'm here because Lori asked me, mm-hmm. it's because of knowing each other from UU.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, and it would be easy to do announcements at UU, but that's one group of people to get. So, you know, unless we go to the Workers' Center, how to change the nature of the voices. Then it gets into what's. I have to say, I joined because of my concerns about who had become president and what was happening. So there was sort of a motivation to want to join. And I'm not sure what that's like for people now.
Mm-hmm.
Joan suggested that we, well, she recommended a young friend of hers who is in, doesn't have, so the ship's status, doesn't have any much skills yet, but does have experience with human rights discrimination from another country. And kind of thought about how the barriers to even participating fully in a setting like this versus, right? You do need to understand the focus. Once you understand, you have that linguistic proficiency.
Mm-hmm.
It is just synthetic, what the audio video recorded. And there are those people who don't have a sense of safety and security. Being a public, representing the numbers of people. So
I think it's also when people are sort of struggling to make a new life, it's asking a lot
Absolutely.
For them to contribute.
Yes, I guess so too. This is not a high priority when you are in this sort of survival mindset. There are challenges for all different groups of people. To talk about people like myself, we know the particular meeting time is probably the busiest in the day. People with no families. It feels like a sacrifice for a lot of people. Take this time away, but so I mean the response has been like, we're so supportive, we're glad that the trustee exists. Especially if there was some sort of crisis that comes up, in the city, we would want to have a commission response. But it's another step for people to say, I want to actively be part of that. So,
yeah. I wonder if there's anybody who can, anybody think of anybody who ran for city council who didn't win? Like, who might want to do something else, Like,
I was actually thinking about that for the entire city.
Because this is a lot of a lighter lift than the city council.
It's difficult for people with full-time jobs or people busy. I do know someone has expressed interest, but again, it's just the 5:30 to 7 a weekday is so difficult.
Yeah.
Actually, go work out of town. And,
Yeah, that's hard for people who work at it.
For me, the 3-year commitment was the big hurdle for me.
Oh, yeah.
Like, just even trying to anticipate what we're up with next year.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. No one wants to, join the board. I'll just leave when it becomes inconvenient.
Right.
I wonder if that's can consider.
It's like a lot of these things, it's aspirational. It's only, because life can intervene. You have to live in the city to be on the board, don't you?
Yes,
I think that's true.
Yes. It's either live here or go to school here or.
Mm-hmm. Work here.
But you can work here?
I thought
you had to live.
Yes. Commissioners must live, work, or be enrolled in school in order to be a member of the trustee of the city of Northampton.
Oh, so you don't have to live here.
But that's interesting. We could get the wonderful young man who did data. He works here still.
Yes. Jeremy.
Jeremy.
Does work here.
Is that why he left? Because he moved?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think we almost do, you have to live in the city.
Well, this is maybe what I will say, but there was a candidate who, a young candidate, who was disqualified because she was not a full-time resident of Northampton. So.
I thought it was interpreted, didn't know.
Yeah, maybe the mayor's, maybe the mayor's preference.
Would be interesting to get that clarified.
Yeah.
What it says in the guidelines and everything.
Karen, you're not the mayor?
Must live, work, or be enrolled in school in order to be a Human Rights Commission, which is what the bylaws says. So I guess you could work in. I guess it sometimes depends on where you work.
I very much thought it was, you know, a bit like, because the city council is not that surely, the city council is trying to live.
Yeah, right.
Like a school committee, you have to live here.
Right, yes.
But maybe the guidelines are different, but different. I somehow assume they're all the same.
I do know this, this young lady who was headed for college was not, you know, didn't qualify, didn't get very far in the application process, just based on residency.
Oh, right, that's right. Yeah. She's going to Brandeis, and that was the question.
Well, she's going to go to Brandeis, that would be quite cheap.
Kind of commute for you.
Yeah. I mean, she wouldn't want to commute once a month. But it would mean that somebody who was at Smith could.
Problem with that is if they go away in the summer. I mean, if they don't live here year round, that's hard.
Do all the Comstock people, are they all, do they live in Northampton or just go to the school?
It's a mix.
Some are likely to live year round.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I don't, yeah. They move here, I think, usually. I really would have thought we could have recruited at the school for social work.
Did we try?
I haven't really, because it's not like I work there.
But your husband does.
That's true.
But that's, again, a very busy group of people.
Yeah, but they also should be contributing to the town.
Yeah.
It's not a huge commitment, really.
This might, some of the issues we're raising might feed into the project that Karen Foster wants to explore.
Yeah.
You know, we've identified some barriers to service. Mm-hmm. That,
yeah, I would wonder how many of the other boards have similar guidelines to ours, mm-hmm. more like them, mm-hmm. and whether there's clarity in that.
So what we can say on the flyers is that there are positions currently open that the Northampton Human Rights Commission promotes and advocates for the protection of human rights in Northampton, advises the mayor and city council, responds to issues
as they arise.
Is that the mission? I mean, you could put the mission.
I just, yeah.
That's the mission.
That's some of it, yeah.
But you could pull it right off the agenda.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, we could have our logo with the T-shirt.
You could also say, you know, it's a place where you can be creative and suggest projects.
Contribute to the well-being of the town.
In a nonpartisan way, that might help people.
We want to reflect the diverse creative voices in this town, in our membership, in our discussions.
We should really say on there directly, we're particularly looking for people who are historically underrepresented.
Yeah, I think that would be. I almost feel like saying, I mean, it's not just that we're looking for them, we hope that they would consider doing it.
Right.
We particularly hope that people.
How about those that people who are historically underrepresented are particularly encouraged to?
Yes.
Consider joining?
Yeah.
Or?
Because we don't make that decision.
Right.
I'll play around with the graphic as it's written.
And then we can put it on our Facebook, we can put it on the city website.
Yeah.
And the mayor.
Yes.
The mayor has a lot of followers.
He does.
If he'll post it, that would be good.
If people interrupt his fact-finding.
Well, we don't even need to do it until next week.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah. Let's just, roughing something out just like that.
You have the gift for that.
You have an app.
Oh, you have an app. Okay. Well,
yeah. Just fill in the blanks on the app.
Okay. What's the app called?
Canva. They have a bunch of different templates and just tracking the information. Canva. Okay. We had, I think it was Megan had the great idea.
So by the way, I'm looking at our website, and I'm seeing that Karen's term ends June 2022, Lori ends this June, you don't end until 2022, I end on June 20.
Of this year?
Yeah.
Oh, so the question is, do you want another term?
Well, let's not go there. I'm just thinking about where the terms are. I do not have plans to.
Yeah.
People are asking me every day at work, am I about to retire?
Oh.
So, I don't have to do that here. Unless you're making a suggestion.
No.
I'm just looking at it.
Actually, no.
But what happened for me is when my term came up, they automatically send me an email and said, assuming that I want to be reappointed.
Yeah, somebody said.
Yeah.
Hamp Powers, I think. So.
Yeah. Okay.
I didn't remember if we spoke.
So might
I spoke or sent an email or. I think I sent somebody else.
I got an email.
And what about Megan?
Is it showing?
2022.
Yeah.
There's nobody 2021.
And they're
all 2022.
And they're all 2022?
Yeah, that's right.
It's interesting, we're all in 2022.
Huh. Okay.
Every grad school must be thinking, I'll take that. I'm going to lose this summer.
Who's that?
No.
Yeah.
I mean, why wouldn't
okay, so
we do not have a good way of onboarding new members. But we can do something about that. So.
Were you starting to say that this was Megan's idea for the last time? Okay.
Yeah.
I wonder if other boards and commissions have something, have some words or if it's for a good question. Maybe not, we don't have to recreate the wheel. I'll ask around.
I would think that a likely place to start would be with the planning department. They have a number of boards that they supervise and I don't know, just knowing the staff there, I think that if anybody has created an onboarding document, it would be them.
Orientation.
Yeah.
You could also ask Cam Powers, right?
Do you think she would have?
Is she the clerk?
Yeah, she's the clerk of the
city. I don't know, I just thought she might have documents.
Yeah.
She's the keeper of the records, right?
Oh, some of the records, not minutes.
Oh, she's not the keeper of minutes? Oh, okay, that's the mayor's office.
Well, the planning department keeps the ones related to their boards.
Okay. I thought she was the holder of all the records.
I know she keeps city council records. I'm not sure about the boards. What do you wish you had when you joined?
No, this was really helpful. Like the bylaws.
Mm-hmm.
That were somewhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Lori had those, right?
Yeah, because you.
And I forgot.
And I think I mentioned just resetting goals of the chair of last year.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe a little bit about historically about rights of issues and encountered and activities.
So list of activities and projects and successes.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if you want to include a very brief bio of the current members, but I felt like it took me a while to get that from any of you, just from the meetings alone.
Mm-hmm.
Cover letter to go with it.
Welcome to the commission.
I always thought it might have been helpful to have some sample minutes.
Okay.
Minutes would be samples from the
minutes from the previous few meetings.
Yeah, or one or two or something.
Something I'd be happy to kind of assemble, and you know, aside from the little short bios, you know, kind of send that.
together a draft.
That's great.
For our next meeting.
Promising, knowing how busy March is going to be. I shouldn't do this.
And
well, time like that.
Good. I was going to say, maybe each of us sends you two sentences of a letter.
Right. And then what courage is bringing up? What motivated you to join this commission?
Well, the thing is pulling together things, but it's not necessarily, I guess, you have the bylaws. I guess you would have to write up the thing about the chair and vice chair. Mm-hmm. You probably need a little help with the list of activities and projects. And the typical agenda, you have that.
Yeah. Well, I did explore that a little bit for the guest column end of last year.
Activity?
Going into our, yes.
Oh, good. Great.
That's right. History.
Yeah.
What the commission has done, but I mean, are there any particular kind of things we should highlight?
Civility pledge.
Civility pledge.
The report to the mayor that was just done.
Pretty concrete kind of,
The listening circles.
The listening circles.
Collaborating with Northampton Connect. And, you know, historically, some kind of commemoration of International Human Rights Day.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And just in the past couple of years, beginning to reach out to other human rights commissions in mm-hmm. Massachusetts to build a coalition.
Mm-hmm. Going to the Gay Pride March as a commission?
Mm-hmm.
Participating. I have a question, maybe you know the answer to this. Where do the archives of the Human Rights Commission live? Are they all online?
Historically, in the fourth drawer of the file cabinet in the mayor's office, but largely digital now.
Okay. Because what I was wondering is, what if there's something like that? Do we care? You know, but what if somebody did that a long time ago?
Did an orientation book?
Yeah. Anyway.
Yeah, if it was longer ago, then it might be in the old files. The old timey files.
Maybe it doesn't matter.
So the digital files are accessible through the mayor's office? Where are they? We wanted to say.
Yeah, yes, I am way behind in getting them the minutes to, I just have to convert everything to PDF.
It's not just send it. I don't see any reason for any of the boards.
Okay. Yeah. So I do need to get on that, but yes, I send them to court mm-hmm. and then he or somebody puts them on the website. They don't want to give access to the content management system to us.
I was really interested to learn recently how long the Human Rights Commission has been going. Mm-hmm. I didn't realize it. Mm-hmm. And I kind of vaguely known about it over the years. Mm-hmm. It's interesting. It gives you a sense of context.
Here is that packet should include bylaws, description of roles of chair and vice chair, list of activities, project successes, brief bio, current member, typical agenda, cover letter, minutes from previous meetings, and that Megan volunteered to assemble the pieces. And that we all will give her a couple of lines of bio.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Now the bylaws, don't the bylaws say there's supposed to be a clerk as well? Mm-hmm.
Oh, why said I do that for?
Yes, you're doing it for. Just for tonight or for the duration of your time?
No, for the duration.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's another role. Unless I can find out otherwise, we may have to organize ourselves by those roles. Get through the bylaws. Thank you, Megan. Collating all of that.
Would be helpful to circulate this before our meeting so we can look at it. And just come here and discuss how we agree.
Okay.
Okay, Lori, do you have an update on the non-citizen drivers?
Well, no, I think that would just be you, that if you sent it out. You know what I mean? Like I sent you the, that was just on there because what we were gonna do since the last meeting was send something to the Human Rights Commission.
Across the state.
Yeah.
I failed to do that.
Oh, okay. Do you remember that I sent you that thing?
I do.
Oh, okay.
I do.
Okay. And
it got lost.
Okay.
I still have the list of the other commissioners, so
I think it's all still relevant what I sent you. And just will you copy Margaret on that one? Margaret Sawyer.
Yep. So I was looking online to find out what the current status of the Work and Family Mobility Act was. This is what encompasses the ones with the driver's license issues. And it sounds like the governor has come out against it.
Right. Yeah, he said he would veto it.
But it's but the supporters are trying to, you know, they're trying to amend the law a bit. So like dropping the real ID kind of option for non-citizens, but focusing on the fact that at least 12 states do grant some form of state ID to non-citizens.
What percentage?
I think I'm reading an article from WBUR article from end of January this year. And it says here, oh no, January last year, sorry, I should look for something more recent. So, but I did see another list of like 16 states, this year I say 12, but 16 states do offer IDs.
And I know from a friend that people who live in Oregon, it isn't legal there, they all go to Washington and get it. Mm-hmm. From Washington, where it is. I don't know how they get it. Maybe they have friends who live in Washington State, but that is the practice.
So it seems like this is getting a lot of support, though. I mean, the sheriffs came out in favor of it, the DA came out in favor of it. I mean, and I wonder if we should send a letter to the governor and say, what gives? This is just a basic thing, you know?
And not just our group, but like the Coalition of Human Rights.
Yeah.
Yes.
Maybe we should ask them if they want to do it together. So you're going to send it off to the other HRCs and the Coalition, or is the Coalition the other HRCs?
It's the other HRCs.
Okay.
All the ones that we're aware of.
Okay.
There's a new human rights office, part of the Boston Mayor's office. There's a human rights commissioner. This is new. I met that person at the October meeting. That was so cool.
So oh, really?
To figure out, as a former state rep. All connected people.
Do you
having this discussion.
I'm sorry, one more thing.
Yeah, I wish I asked my council if this was going to be on the agenda, so if there's going to be a resolution of any sort.
For our city council?
Yeah.
Do you remember?
I haven't attended since last year, but.
Wait, so what was the meeting that you and I went to?
That was for Safe City ordinance.
Oh, okay. Okay. I don't know the answer to that.
A lot of other things going on right now.
Yeah.
But again, if it does come up, you know, none of us could show up.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, the police chief is, I mean, I think they have Northampton, you know, I mean, that effort has Northampton.
Oh, yeah. Like codified.
More troubling about the mayor, I mean, the governor. Booker, did you want to say anything about your column?
It's in limbo.
Did they get in touch with you at all?
No.
Oh.
It was not, I assume it's because I'm not talking about.
Oh, the override?
Yeah.
I sent an article about why I joined the Human Rights Commission to the Gazette, but it's, and Lori helped me. But I've not heard, I feel like I submitted an article with no internal, but I haven't heard anything from them, so.
If you don't, I would email them back, because they sometimes, you could have fallen through the cracks. But maybe, yeah, maybe, it might be just that they're backed up, because they are having a lot of columns.
Yeah, they're doing a lot of. And my reasons for joining have nothing to do with the override.
Yeah, right.
Is there a human rights issue to the override?
Oh, you know, yeah.
There is to everything.
I mean, yeah.
Probably find it.
Well, it's interesting, because the discussions are about affordability of the city. Those are the interesting, those are the ones that are interesting to me.
Well, they're about balancing people's rights and needs. The right to a decent education versus the right to be able to live here.
Would you be able to take a clear position for or against the override?
Well, I know that I'm for the override, but I'm also, that's why the thing that makes me think are the idea of being on a fixed income and what does that next $200 mean? So I grew up in California when Reagan was the governor and started Prop 2.5. And that's where it sort of began before he became president. And sort of watched the public school system in California go through the floor.
Which was great.
It was great, yeah. It was the best, probably one of the best public school systems in the country. And even the University of California system. So, though people loved the fact that taxes stopped going up a lot. So, yeah, in my heart of hearts from going through that experience, I would always be for it. But, it's like, what does it mean to not be able to live here? Mm-hmm. And that was actually sort of what happened in our civility discussions. It was about income equality, can you live here, can you not live here? So I've been thinking about it, but I don't see it.
I think that, you know, make a case either way.
Yeah.
And something should stay away from. Because it's not clear, really. I mean, like I said, it's just argue it either way.
I don't think we can possibly go there. It's a complex.
I mean, as a commission.
I think as a commission.
Just check.
But, I mean, but I do think we could have a, we could, if we want to continue this, sending regular letters in as a group, we could come out with something about the driver's license thing.
So I would want to time it close to discussion in the city council or something.
Close to what?
Like if it came up in city council, like.
So, yeah, I guess we should find out if they're going to take it up.
Yes. And for some reason, at the end of last year, there were a number of op-eds about it. I think maybe before, about the act worker mobility acts. But yeah, so.
I can ask Jim Louise, the new chair for the city council president.
Great. Okay, so we'll come back to this next time.
We'll come back to it.
Okay.
The all-gender bathrooms.
Yeah, I kept that on there. I mean, I don't have anything to report, but I also think that's something that we should work with the city council on. But
do you know if there is any other municipal legislation about municipal policies about that?
Bathrooms?
Yeah.
When we were looking into it at the beginning, there was something in the plumbing code about the bathrooms. But I can't remember what it was.
There's something in the plumbing code.
Yes, and I don't know if it was about separate stalls or, I can't remember. I mean, if there, I think there might be something, but we have to do a little research.
Okay.
Anyway.
Would you be able to do any research before the next meeting about if there's any other?
The bathroom?
Yeah, if there's any other municipal regulation or
sure.
legislation that's been done.
You mean in other communities?
Yeah,
or,
okay. Yeah. Like if there's a model.
Oh, okay.
That somebody else has adopted. That
that's a really good. I will do that.
As long as we discuss all these issues, it strikes me, you know, you just start with the override. There are two different groups of people's interests there.
Mm-hmm.
So there's, you know, and both of them clearly human rights issues. And the driving license thing doesn't take away from anybody else. I mean, it seems to me it's about giving people who need it something, but it doesn't take away. For me, similarly, the bathrooms. As long as you've got stalls, it seems to me to cost about $10 to change the sign.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that isn't how everybody thinks.
Often. Yeah, right.
But I mean, it seems to be something, a way to think about it.
It gets complicated when you talk about schools. So should they all the bathrooms be genderless or not? And that's
Yes, I think you're right. I think it's complicated.
Yes, I'm sure it does. And there've been certain ones that have been forever. Like I know Connecticut College has had genderless ones for 30 years or maybe more. And that may be true of other places too.
That is more controversial in the high schools than it is in the elementary schools, because they are, there are gender, all gender bathrooms right now, Jackson Street.
Oh, yeah.
Elementary, oh, yeah.
All of them are, or there just are some that are?
The prominent ones, the ones that are most accessible to the public and, you know, first floor. So they're definitely making a statement.
Are they multiple stall ones?
They are single stall.
Okay, well, see, single stall, yeah, it's like.
That seems to me, yeah.
That's something that can be done without.
I think there are, they maintain the boys and girls bathrooms on other floors, but, yeah.
Well, it's the multiple stall ones that people find trickier, you know.
It's kind of a little hanging fruit, the single stall.
Oh, yeah, so, yes, everybody should be doing that.
We all have them in our houses.
Exactly. Exactly.
Exactly.
All right. Yeah, I mean, and then I think it is complicated, because then what happens at like a homeless shelter? Yeah, I don't know the answer to that one either. I'm assuming they have. Well, maybe they have single stalls though.
See where it gets into. So the Academy of Music has separate bathrooms. And which leads to problems. That's a kind of public space where they moved towards, said, we're going to move towards children's bathrooms. That's where things would, that's where it would get difficult.
Well, actually, but they have done that. They've done that, but they don't say all gender bathrooms. They just have pictures of what's in the bathroom.
Right, yeah.
So people can choose where they want to go, but that's essentially not all, both of them are all gender bathrooms. But.
Yeah, and then you get into the complicated thing of, you have, you know, three stalls in the men's, and you have three stalls in the women's, and there's a line 200, you know, so yeah. Women waiting, and none of them met. I mean, you have. And then really, I suppose, we're all going to have to move to single stall. I mean, and that's more expensive. Not here, you have.
Well, the UU has some. There's still urinals in the UU, but there are curtains around the urinal. So you can choose where you're going, and without pulling the urinals.
And there are multiple stalls, and we just got a little rubber thing to put, because, you know, the gap in the stalls, people didn't like that, so it seems to be working, no problems. Both of them are all changing.
I'm saying, like, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
When I was in Europe briefly, I remember all the public bathrooms were all gender.
Yeah.
And they seem to, I mean, they're designed to address the privacy or safety issue for people, but being very, almost like a number of single stalls together, you know, they have with the ceiling, walls between each. There's a lock on each door, a secure lock. So there's, it's very possible. Of course, all of this takes more funding.
But we're going to get there. It's going to be like the ADA.
I think the future is new buildings are going to be designed. It's going to be retrofitting.
That's just
buildings.
I have two friends of mine who are older women, a couple, and one of them badly broke her ankle. They were in the Amsterdam airport looking for a handicapped bathroom, looking everywhere. And finally they found the sign, which was through the men's room, which is a very extensive men's room, with a very long line of urinals. So my friend pushed my partner very determinedly. They went through. And then they had to come back.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Okay.
That was a number of years ago. Maybe they changed.
Under new business,
I got an email today from Wayne Fiden, who is the chair, who's the department head for planning and sustainability. And it's that time of year where they do the CDBG grants again. And he sent me out the proposed dates of the meetings. It's usually 3 days of meetings. And of course, Peg Keller's not doing it this year, so I don't know how the process will be changed, but it's a big ask to be able to go to all of those meetings. But it's also
consecutive days?
It's not necessarily consecutive days, but all the dates are within a 2-week period. Mm-hmm. So it's a big chunk of time in a 2-week period.
So they're asking for a representative from different commissions and boards?
Well, not all commissions and boards. Yeah. Just there's a representative from the city council, mm-hmm. From the housing partnership.
Disability commission?
No, I don't think so. Mm-hmm. No. I think, so last year it was Marion LaBarge and Gina Lee Sierra, although Marion does sit on the Disabilities Commission, and Gina Lee's on Community Services. And then there's Ted from the Housing Partnership, and there's a general community member who also had housing experience and Human Rights Commission.
Did they give sort of dates? Or at least a 2-week window.
Yes.
And they're like the same person at all of them, right?
Yes. I've done it before. I'm willing to do it, but it is a great, it was a great learning experience for me to just see all of the applicants and to help think about where our resources get allocated. So I would be happy to share that. So there are dates from Wednesday the 4th of March through Wednesday the 11th. And I can send these to you if you would be interested in looking at them.
And the particular chunks of time. 3 days.
Yes. Again, how long the meetings last year, I think, were 2 hours each. Looking forward to this.
How many how many would you hear about in 2 hours?
Each one had about 15 minutes or 20 minutes.
They're live presentations, they're not written.
No, you get a packet of documents in advance so you can mark up. They give a brief overview of what they've been doing, what they plan to do, and then any questions you have.
And are the meetings during the day or
not? They are during the day.
It sounds kind of familiar, like what we call grants review committees that I've facilitated. So I feel like I would definitely contribute a lot as a human rights issue, but the process itself sounds very familiar to me.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like if you are willing to, if you're willing to go,
it happens that those times are available. I have chunks of time in those windows, so I could do it, but I'm going to send you guys the dates and times anyway.
So then, could we perhaps sub for you if something does come up? If I could serve as an alternate?
Mm-hmm.
If one of those days did not work out?
Sure. I mean, it's... Mm-hmm. Ideally, they like to have everyone at all of the presentations because at the end, you compare.
Mm-hmm. If you vote on prioritizing.
Yeah, X number of dollars to give out, you know, based on what you're seeing.
What are the dates?
I just sent you in an email, they range from Wednesday the 4th.
Oh, what month?
Of March. So this is next week.
Oh, okay. So I get, the only reason I was asking is because we have to say in the minutes, I didn't know if we were going to talk about it next time. So it sounds like we have to decide now. Yeah, okay. So I don't have any interest in or capacity to do it.
Okay.
So I'm not running for that.
Where you are.
What?
Just to be able to cancel stuff.
Yeah, this is very short notice.
So it sounds like, Karen, it's you.
Yeah, it would be very hard for me. Oh, I see. So you have to choose these times. You can choose from the time.
Yes, he's trying to get everybody's availability right now. So we don't even know which of these dates sometimes.
Okay, so Karen, can I put in the minutes you're doing it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. Yay, Karen.
Thank you. But I think last year you let us, you gave us a mini report on mm-hmm. what things were like.
Yes.
That would be good.
Thanks for doing that.
Mm-hmm. Any other new business anybody wants to bring up? I would entertain a motion to adjourn 6 minutes early.
Who's making it?
Somebody has to move. I was entertaining the motion. I was making it.
So moved.